Welcome to the County Manager's Report. I'm Lloyd Higuera. With me is Douglas County Manager Steve Mokrohiesky. Welcome, Steve.
Thanks, Lloyd. Great to be here.
And we're going to talk about the recent Douglas County Board of Commissioners meeting and lots of plans on the
table. We had a good time.
Yeah.
As we always do.
We do. I still
say very efficient, very effective.
I still say we need snacks for the audience.
So. I'll take that under advisement.
Yeah, okay. All right. I just keep mentioning it.
Okay.
Someday.
All right.
In my wildest dreams.
Yeah, I'll bring you a Snickers next time.
All right. The Snickers, I like those. Commissioners did discuss a master plan amendment at the meeting, replacing Chapter 2 of the land use element. That's the State Line Kingsbury Community Plan, with a new plan, the South Shore Area Plan. Now, commissioners took no action on this, but they did discuss the transition here. Can you tell us what they discussed and, you know, what are the implications of the plan?
Sure, and this is really the purpose of this area plan and all of the planning efforts that we're now going through at the local level is to implement the actions taken by the Tahoe Regional Planning Agency's governing board when they adopted the regional plan update in December of 2012. And so if you recall, we've been through a several year process. Over 5,000 people participated in the TRPA's regional plan update. It was part of Senate Bill 271 that was passed by the legislature and the governors of Nevada and California. And the legislatures have been very supportive of getting that new regional plan for the Tahoe Basin updated. So as a result of that, it allows local governments around the Tahoe Basin to participate in creating local planning areas. So that's what we're now doing and we've been doing for the past several months in Douglas County, is working on a South Shore area plan that encompasses, this first phase encompasses the state line in Lower Kingsbury areas, and then the second phase that will come forward later this year, around September, October of 2013, will be the rest of Tahoe in Douglas County. So on the South Shore, so that's the purpose of this South Shore area plan that we're pursuing, that the board did the first hearing of the three ordinances. We also have the resolution, as you said, on the master plan. All of those three, you know, we want to have them, these are sort of the first hearings, and then we'll have that continued to the June 20th board meeting, where the board will be asked to adopt the resolution on the master plan amendment and the three ordinances. And then it will get forwarded to the Tahoe Regional Planning Agency's governing board in July for their approval. If the governing board ultimately approves it, then those area plans will be in place and we can go forward and pursue implementation of the things that are allowed within the South Shore Area Plan. This has been a very public process. As I said, over 5,000 people participated in the regional plan update. We've had several public workshops for our South Shore Area Plan, and a lot of participation, a lot of public comment that's been incorporated into the South Shore Area Plan. A couple of interesting things to note about Douglas County. Here, from an environmental standpoint, sometimes people talk about Nevada and California and who's friendly to the environment. Well, let me set the stage for the fact that Douglas County has the highest best management practices, BMP compliance, in the Tahoe Basin, meaning that commercial and residential properties invest the most in Douglas County of any other place in the basin in making improvements to their properties that reduce stormwater runoff and create deterioration in lake clarity. While Douglas County has 18% of the total shoreline for Lake Tahoe, we contribute only 3% of the fine sediment load that finds its way into the lake and is what creates that deterioration in lake clarity, the TMDL issue, if you will, the total maximum daily load issue. So we have, in Douglas County, we also have made a significant number of investments, both in the public and the private side, in water quality improvements, environmental improvement projects that further reduce the fine sediment and stormwater load that find their way into the lake. So we have a record in Douglas County of strong environmental redevelopment and improvement in the basin. And what the regional plan that the TRP governing board approved in the South Shore area plan and the next phase of the area plans will allow us to do is to continue to build upon that record. Everything in the regional plan and the area plans are structured around improving the environment, improving the economy, and improving the community in Lake Tahoe. We have socioeconomic conditions that have really struggled over the past decade. Gaming revenues have declined 38%. Employment has declined 52%, population has declined 22%, school enrollment has declined 48%, and homes, 49% of all homes in Douglas County in Tahoe, in Lake Tahoe, are owned by second homeowners, meaning we have a transient population, which creates a challenge for a community. So, again, these are challenges that we face. We have a strong record of environmental protection and investment. And what we're trying to do with the regional plan and the area plan is allow for environmental redevelopment of the built environment. So if you go, you know, you drive into Lake Tahoe and you see this beautiful, pristine lake, and then you get into the human-built infrastructure, and this has happened to me routinely when I bring family and friends who come from out of the area, they go, this is so beautiful, and then they get into the state line South Shore corridor, and they go, wow, the buildings and the infrastructure are really run down. This is surprising. Why doesn't it look more like areas in Colorado, Vail and Breckenridge and Keystone and these destination-type communities that have walkable, pedestrian-friendly amenities with retails and streetscapes, complete streets, and it's an inviting environment. It's positive for the natural environment, and it's an inviting place for pedestrians, for residents and visitors to do. So I'm being a little long-winded here, Lloyd, the response, but I want to give a flavor for what we're trying to do ultimately with these area plans is allow private investors, the commercial and residential property owners, to make the investments in their properties that will actually improve the clarity of the lake and the overall environment and improve the economy and the general sense of community that we have at Lake Tahoe. So that's the purpose. We do have a challenge with the regional plan in that it's held up in litigation. While the vast majority of the environmental community supported the regional plan and has been supportive of Douglas County's South Shore Area Plan, participated in the discussions, given us thoughtful comments, including the League to Save Lake Tahoe and the Nevada Conservation League, the Sierra Club, its local chapter sued the regional plan. And so we continue to try and make the argument that those who truly care about the environment are getting behind these planning efforts to make sure and understand that in order to protect the environment, we have to allow for redevelopment of the existing built environment because the status quo is what's actually contributing to the environmental decline that we have.
Well, that's a good overview. What does it mean on the ground, though, for Joe Tahoe, you know, the average citizen? What will this plan, once it's approved, mean for them?
Well, and what it allows for is, there's a recognition in Lake Tahoe that doing things, we have several different local jurisdictions spread across two different states, and then you've got TRPA, bi-state regulatory agency. There's a lot of government, and there's a lot of regulation, and a lot of independent entities doing their own thing. The recognition, I think, around the regional plan and these area plans is we need to start coordinating on a regional basis, not only to improve the environment, but to improve the economy and our overall community. So that's kind of a basic concept that's put forward here is the total maximum daily load effort, the stormwater reduction, the best management practice implementation, and the redevelopment of the built environment needs to be coordinated. It can't just be done in silos and based on parochial interests, but there needs to be a collective understanding, the common good of the lake clarity and the community and the economy there. So there are benefits to residents from that standpoint that we're really trying to, as opposed to regulating every individual resident that lives at Lake Tahoe and saying you need to make your BMP investment in your property, we're trying to look at where are we going to get the biggest bang for the buck here and focus on regulating BMPs, TMDL, environmental water quality improvements in areas where they'll have the biggest impact, rather than trying to spread across everything. So that's one area, I think, better regional collaboration, cooperation, planning, and regulation. And then it also allows for local agencies to enter into memorandums of understanding, which we'll talk about next, to have the local agency begin to do permitting for certain things as opposed to TRPA. Many residents today, particularly in Douglas County, have to go to TRPA for any type of change or redevelopment or addition or new construction that they want to add to their property. They then also have to come to Douglas County for permitting. So it's a two or three stop shop. And what we're able to do through these new plans is enter into an understanding with TRPA, where local jurisdictions, as Douglas County has now, will take over those permitting efforts. And so now residents will be able to deal with a one-stop shop. We're still going to be enforcing and regulating the same regulations and policies that TRPA has in place, but at least residents and businesses will be dealing with one versus two agencies. So a couple of examples there. And then when you look at the long-term vision for what we're trying to do with the commercial corridors, it really is to create a greater sense of community. You've got a five-lane state highway that cuts through the downtown South Shore State Line corridor. It does not create an inviting place for residents and visitors to live and to recreate and to access the lake and to experience retail and restaurant and other operations. And so all of those things are benefits that will come as a result of this regional plan. Greater recreational opportunities, greater access to the lake, more coordinated retail operations, and better enforcement on a regional basis of BMP and TMDL compliance.
Okay, good answer.
All right.
You mentioned the Memorandum of Understanding. Commissioners approved that, and that was for the new South Shore Area Plan. And how does that tie in to the whole thing?
So the Douglas County, interestingly, is the only local jurisdiction in the Tahoe Basin that doesn't currently have an MOU, a Memorandum of Understanding with TRPA, to do residential permitting. And so the board at its meeting in May at the lake approved the MOU with TRPA, and we will come back then once this new area plan is updated to amend that so that it's consistent with the new area plan. But our MOU with TRPA will delegate residential activities in Douglas County to Douglas County. So no longer will residents go to TRPA for things like new single-family and multifamily development, up to 4 units of single-family and multifamily development, residential additions and modifications, and residential exempt and qualified exempt activities will all come to Douglas County. And the thought there is that local residents are more comfortable and typically can get better responsive and proactive customer service from their local government than they can from a bi-state agency. The larger they say government closest to the people governs best. And so we think that we can provide better service, more responsive service to our residents than TRPA has been able to do. TRPA will provide training to Douglas County staff. Douglas County will collect TRPA fees and securities and retain a percentage of those fees, so we'll actually get revenue as a result of the service that we're providing. We will do regular monitoring and tracking of things like TMDL and BMP and other compliance. And it also requires development of procedural guidelines and residential permitting for Douglas County. So we're still accountable for the same regulations. We still have to report to TRPA and enforce what they have in place, but we're hopeful that through this it'll provide a one-stop shop for residents and it will give them access to a more responsive customer service focused entity than they have had prior to this.
Okay, so this will all come back to commissioners on June 20th?
The MOU was approved. So okay. The MOU is in place now once it's executed with TRPA. We'll have an amended MOU that'll come forward in, it'll be later this year with the new MOU. The other items on the area plan will come back on June 20th.
Okay. This next one's kind of exciting. Commissioners approved.
Now, how was the last one not exciting?
Well, this means jobs.
Okay, fair enough.
I mean,
fair
enough. Stuff this, that excites me.
I know,
me.
It's a little esoteric talk about, yeah. You know, the planning and development, you know, how does that really impact people?
No, actually,
but it is important.
The first two items are not only interesting, but they're historic.
Yes.
You know, so,
all right, thank
so
you.
Now I have to wait everything. But commissioners approved sending 4 letters of support to the Governor's Office of Economic Development for incentives for 4 new companies
right. That
are coming to Douglas County. So what kind of incentives, who's coming, and potentially how many jobs could this mean here in Douglas County?
Right, and these are exciting, Lloyd. You're absolutely right that as you look at these 4 different companies and you look at what we've been through over the past 4 to 5 years with the economic decline locally, the loss of 3,000 jobs that we faced, the unemployment rate, loss of tax revenue, the challenges that residents and and businesses have faced. It's exciting now to be in a position where we're talking about four new businesses with a total of several hundred new jobs that are coming to Douglas County. Many of these, most of them, are very well-paying, self-sustaining, family-sustaining type jobs, and it's investment in the community, people buying and leasing properties. So this is great news. The first of the four businesses, Christech Interconnects, is an aerospace manufacturer specializing in interconnecting harnesses and various applications related to missile, aircraft, satellite, and military equipment. They're locating in Minden, in the Carson Valley in Douglas County, and there's approximately 90 new jobs associated with this business. There's an average wage of $25 per hour. That's just the wage, not the benefits that would come on top of that. And the annual payroll is estimated in the first year to be $4.7 million. So that's exciting. The incentives that are being proposed, Douglas County doesn't approve the incentives. They're state-approved incentives, but we're providing a letter of support to the state on this and encouraging them to support our board, approve that unanimously. They're for personal property tax and sales tax abatements for a period of time. Before I go on to the other businesses, I'll just make a comment that Doug Sonneman, our Douglas County assessor, was at the meeting and shared really valuable insight with the board and the public about the value of these tax abatements to these businesses. And he used Starbucks roasting plant as an example in Minden, where their property is now, where Starbucks is now the fourth highest valued property in Douglas County. The fourth highest valued property in Douglas County. And you look at the debt, he provided a dollar amount of the tax abatements that Starbucks was provided for a period of time versus the investment that they've made, the assessed value that they have, the property taxes they now pay, the sales taxes, the employment, and everything else. And the benefits that we've gained from Starbucks being in our community and the jobs and the revenue and everything that it provides far exceed any tax abatement that was available there. And so I think it was a really helpful insight to show that these abatements are helpful in getting businesses an incentive to get them to relocate, and it's in our long-term best interest to do that. The second business, East Biz Corporation, is a logistics shipping company that specializes in shipping programs to all companies that do not ship products directly. And they'll be located in Minden. 75 new jobs, approximately $18 per hour average wage, and the first year $1.2 million average payroll that'll go up to $3 million by the fourth year.
Wow.
The third business, New Logic Research, is an engineering and manufacturing of high-end state and state-of-the-art filtration systems. They're relocating both their headquarters and their manufacturing facility to Minden, and they have approximately 50 new jobs. The average wage, hourly wage, is $24 per hour, and the annual payroll is $2.5 million. These are not small numbers.
Right.
The final business is Public Restrooms Company. They're a leading manufacturer of business restroom facilities. They're looking to purchase or lease a 65,000-square-foot facility, a large facility. Of course, we have a lot of available commercial square footage in Douglas County, and so it's exciting to look at a manufacturer of this type coming in and taking over that type of square footage. New jobs of 35 new jobs from this company, an average hourly wage of $17 per hour, and an annual payroll of approximately $1.3 million. Per hour. So significant number of jobs, a livable family-supporting wage associated with each of these companies, and significant investment in the community. And so we're excited to welcome all of them.
And all really clean industries.
They are.
Too.
They're consistent, exactly. You know, we're not looking for any business that wants to relocate here. We like the clean air, the quality of life, and the type of businesses that we have. And so we're trying to attract businesses that fit our outdoor recreation, lifestyle, manufacturing, technology, science-based industries that are here in Douglas County.
Great news. Well, a presentation was also made at the meeting by Lisa Granahan, Economic Vitality Manager, and this is regarding the new state brand, Nevada, a world within, a state apart.
It's catchy, isn't it?
What do you think?
Yeah, I like it. This is a result of the Nevada Commission on Tourism and the development of the new state brand at the request of Governor Brian Sandoval, who asked for this to be done. So the result of it is, as you say, the new brand, Nevada, a world within, a state apart. It will be used for everything from tourism to economic development and education, job training. There's now a television campaign that's going to be airing, featuring the brand. It's about, I think it's about a 30 to 45 second television ad. Really catchy. It's got the band The Killers from Las Vegas that do the music for it, and it's kind of takes you on a very brief tour around the state to show the diversity of the state, the beautiful climate, the wonderful activities. And this is going to air. It was kicked off April 15th, and it's airing in Los Angeles, San Francisco, and Phoenix. And so you see, we're not airing it locally, so local residents are not going to see it. We don't need to tell our local residents what they already know, but we want to let the folks in California and in Arizona know what's available here and to come up and visit us here in Nevada. So a neat new brand and campaign that the state is kicking off.
Okay. Commissioners also gave direction to county staff. This was concerning the Douglas County Liquor Code, and this was concerning live entertainment endorsements. Why did this come up? Were we having a problem there?
Well, we've heard from some businesses, particularly some restaurant and bar establishments in the town of Genoa, who are wanting to do more outdoor event, live music type events, particularly in the summer months. There's a demand for this. We all like to, you know, spend time outside in the wonderful summer weather, and we like to enjoy music. The current liquor code, which the board did just approve about a year ago, less than a year ago, on July 5th, 2012, the board updated the liquor code, which had been gone about 20 years without a major revamp. So they updated that. But we've gotten some requests from some establishments in the community who are looking for more than what's allowed in the code of four. There's a restriction of four outdoor live entertainment endorsements. It's called live entertainment endorsements per year. They feel that's too restrictive and it should be increased. There's a balance, of course, to this, because you have some bars and restaurants that operate in general commercial areas where there aren't residentials. There isn't a neighborhood or residential impact. And then you have others that are in a neighborhood type area, what's called neighborhood commercial. The Tombstone Tap and Grill, I'll give you as an example, is a neighborhood commercial zoning district, and the Genoa Bar is a general commercial. So they have different uses and different restrictions because there's a recognition that one is closer to a neighborhood and could have more impact on residents, and the other is further away and would have less impact on residents. So these issues are all being balanced, but we are going to take a look at how we can provide some flexibility, as the board directed us to, within the liquor code to allow businesses where there's a demand and where it's feasible and appropriate within a community and in a neighborhood, and where it can be supported by residents, that will be allowed. And so this will come forward for at least two more hearings of the board. This was just the initial discussion, and the desire of the board at this meeting was generally to pursue allowing some additional flexibility for these businesses to have more than four outdoor live entertainment events per year.
Okay. Approval was also given by commissioners to a list and prioritization of projects for inclusion in the nine-county Western Nevada Development District's economic development strategy.
And this was a result, as you say, WNDD, the Western Nevada Development District, represents our nine counties in Western Nevada. They've completed the development of the Stronger Economies Together process, which looks at the nine-county blueprint for economic development and identifies key investments in projects, capital investments in projects that would be needed to spur additional economic development. And so it's a valuable exercise. We put forward our list of projects to WNDD to then pursue federal funding for these where there may not be local funding available, at least initially. Many of these projects are public utility. They're either transportation road-related improvements or water and sewer-related improvements or some recreation-based. So I'll give you an idea. Sewer plant expansion, Vista Grande Road, South County Waterline, Muller Parkway extension, Sports Aviation Museum at the airport, Pony Express Trail, other trailheads, River Park access. So these are the types of things that have been identified through the county and through the towns of Minden, Gardnerville, and Genoa that We don't have money to fund those investments, and they could have a significant impact on spurring additional economic development.
Okay. Well, we're kind of running out of time on the agenda. I wonder if I could skip a couple of things and go to the report you gave to commissioners on the legislative matters.
Sure.
And you can do any updates that have happened in the last couple of days.
Sure. We're wrapping up. I think, you know, we're in the last couple of weeks of the Nevada legislature's session here, and I'd say that I think things are going well. The budget impacts have been mitigated to Douglas County and to local communities. I think one of the biggest pieces of news that relates to Douglas County is the Tahoe bill, Senate Bill 229, which sought to repeal Senate Bill 271, passed in the last legislative session. It's been a compromise proposed by Governor Sandoval and Governor Brown in California. It looks like moving forward, and it looks like the compact will remain. Nevada and California will remain members of the TRPA compact. We'll keep some pressure to make sure that we have progress there. The voting structure of the governing board is unlikely to change, but we will require a burden of proof when lawsuits are filed, as one has been on the regional plan. So I think generally a good place there. We've worked closely with the Secretary of State on Assembly Bill 139, this state business portal bill, the Silver Flume, Secretary of State's business portal that allow businesses to go on and register. So that seems to be moving in a positive direction. And again, the budget impacts we've mitigated. So there's probably 50 bills here that I could go through that we don't have time for.
Sure.
But my synopsis is we're getting close to the end. And I think compared to the last legislative session, it's been much more successful from Douglas County's standpoint, in that the negative impacts have been mitigated. And there are potentially some areas that have been positive for us.
Great. How about a preview of the upcoming meeting on June 6th?
June 6th, we're planning to have a consideration of a rehearing of the Cole Smith change in zoning from public use to single family residential that was denied at the last meeting. The board will consider a rehearing of that item as was requested by the applicant. We'll also have an item related to the an agreement with the town of Minden for wholesale water service. We spent the better part of the last year negotiating this agreement and the wholesale water rate that we charge to our customers, as well as Indian Hills and Carson City for that. And so that will be an item on that agenda as well. Few other development, sort of house cleaning items. We'll also have, which I'm really excited and looking forward to, is a quarterly financial and strategic planning report. We're going to do quarterly reports now to our board, a comprehensive report on priority-based budgeting, strategic planning, and our finances. And so look forward to talking more about that.
Okay. Probably not too early to mention that the first meeting in July is going to be changed.
Yes, thank you. July 1st. July 4th falls on Thursday, which
right.
would normally be our board meeting. We decided to move it up to Monday just for residents who may be taking vacation or other staff and the board that may desire to take vacation at that time. So 1 p.m. on Monday, July 1st, will be the board's regular standing meeting at the old historic courthouse in Minden. For the month of July.
And one final thing here. The final budget hearing was held last Monday.
It was, May 20th.
And you must feel good about that.
I do.
Happened rather smoothly.
It did. You never know, but I think we had an effective process this year, bringing forward a balanced budget to the board, transferring $1 million, shifting $1 million in existing property tax revenue into preventative road maintenance, balancing our budget, enhancing a few services. I think it was really successful. Pleased with the role that priority-based budgeting is playing in this process, and we're going to go forward and implement that budget. And in 6 months, we'll be back to start talking about next year's budget
again.
Yeah.
Well, Steve, I want to thank you for
the
information you've shared with us here on the County Manager's Report. County Manager Steve Mokro-Heiske, I'm Lloyd Higuera, and we'll see you next time on the County Manager's Report.